Okay, and now without further delay, I'm introducing tonight's speaker, Jonathan Müller. Jonathan is a computer science graduate currently studying physics. I personally feel this alone says a lot. In his spare time, he works on various C++ open source libraries for memory allocation, cache-friendly containers, or parsing. He also blogs about C++ and library development at foodnathan.net. So, Jonathan, welcome to MOOC++, and thanks a lot for sharing your expertise.
So, welcome. Thanks for inviting me, and thanks to everyone who's attending virtually. You actually invited me some time ago to give a talk at the Munich C++ user group, but I said the next time I'll be in Munich, I'll give a talk, but I wasn't in Munich since then, so it's glad that this works out nicely. So my talk is the static initialization order fiasco, or how to properly initialize globals. In particular, this is not a talk that discusses when or when you should not use globals. This is a different talk. For this talk, let's assume we've already decided that global variables are the way to solve the problem. So now we just want to focus how to properly initialize them. Throughout this talk, we will try to write a logger. This logger class should log messages both to cout and some text file, and it should be able to be used at any point during program execution. Now, while writing this talk, I've written a lot of useful code snippets that I wanted to share with you, so I've decided to put them all in a small library. This is the Atom library. You can find it at the URL, and we will basically write most of it during this talk. More information about it towards the end again. So let's take a look at the first attempt of writing a logger. We have our class, we have a member variable that is our file stream, and then we add a default constructor that opens the file, and then we can write to it in the log function. We also declare a global variable, and then later on in the CPP file, we define that global variable. The definition of log should be straightforward. It both writes to the file and to cout, so I have omitted it here. Then we have an application class. This application class has a default constructor that logs application startup, and then we also create a global variable. We compile our program, we run it, and everything works just fine. Then we go ahead, compile it again, slightly differently, and run it, and this time it crashes. So what is going on here? You understand what's going on? We open our debugger, and we discover that when we open the log file, that when we try to log it in the constructor of the application class, we end up writing to a logger that hasn't been constructed. Both logger and application have non-trivial default constructors that do actual work. So they must be called at some point. When are they called exactly, and in particular, in what order? So we need to understand the rules for global variable initialization. And to understand those, we have to look at two concepts from the C++ standard. The first concept is storage duration. Storage duration controls when storage for an object is allocated. Every object has to live in some memory, and storage duration controls when that memory is allocated. The standard defines four kinds of storage duration classes. The first one is automatic storage duration. In automatic storage duration, this is the storage duration of all variables that are defined in some function. Their memory is allocated at the opening brace, and it's deallocated at the closing brace. The second kind is dynamic storage duration. Dynamic storage duration is all dynamically allocated memory, and it has the obvious allocation and deallocation points. You completely control when storage is allocated and deallocated. Then we've got thread local storage. Thread local storage has thread storage duration and is allocated when the thread starts and deallocated when the thread is joined at the end and then destroyed. So this is the storage that is available throughout the entire thread. And finally, we've got static storage duration. This is the storage duration for all globals. It is allocated when the program starts and deallocated when the program ends. So global objects live in memory that is available throughout the entire lifetime of the application. There are basically three different kinds of objects that have static storage duration. The first are variables that are defined in global or namespace scope, your traditional global variable. Then we've got everything declared with the static keyword. So member variables of a class that are declared static. You have one object for every class. Those live in static storage duration. And also function local variables that are declared in web static. Collectively, I will refer to all of them as globals in this talk, even though especially function local statics aren't really global in that sense. But they have static storage duration and they have similar rules. So I'll cover them as well. The second concept is lifetime. Lifetime controls when the constructor and destructor of an object is called. So in this snippet, we have an automatic variable with automatic storage duration, and its lifetime starts when control flow first reaches the definition. The lifetime ends at the closing brace. As you can see with this example, lifetime in general is not the same as storage duration. The storage for our automatic variable is allocated at the opening brace, but the lifetime only starts once control flow reaches the definition. And in particular, the same storage can hold multiple objects with distinct lifetimes. This happens when we explicitly call the destructor of an object and then later construct another one in the same storage. With that terminology in mind, we can formulate our question more precisely. To understand what's going on with the logger example, we want to know when does the lifetime of variables with static storage duration begin? Because it seems like we run into some issue of initialization order. The standard basically says that global variables are initialized in two phases. The first phase is static initialization. This happens at compile time or when the program is loaded into memory. Basically the entire memory is set to zero. The second phase is dynamic initialization, and there the initializing expression is actually executed. So on the following code snippet, we have two global variables, a string and a size string. After static initialization, the string will contain a couple of null pointers and size t will be zero. Then dynamic initialization takes place that actually initializes the object. So for the string, it allocates some memory, copies the characters over, and sets the pointer. For the size t, it goes to the string and queries the size. But as we can see, this snippet only works if the string is initialized before the size t. So when we have dynamic initialization and we access some other global, whether or not that works depends on the order of initialization. So what is the order of dynamic initialization? The standard says order of dynamic initialization is not specified, with the big exception that within one translation unit, variables are initialized from top to bottom. So in this example, we have two translation units. A translation unit is basically a source file after all the headers have been pasted in. So we've got two translation units, config.cpp and user.cpp. In config.cpp, we define a global isStream object, and in config, and some config object that reads the configuration from the global file. Then in user.cpp, we define a global key and then looks up whether a certain flag is set in the configuration. We know that within each translation unit, the variables are initialized from top to bottom. So we first initialize file and then config and then key and then isVerbose. But because isVerbose also accesses config, and config is defined in a different translation unit, this is problematic because we don't know whether isVerbose will be initialized first or config. If isVerbose is initialized first, our program has an error because it accesses a config object that hasn't been initialized. Those are the basic rules, and there are two special cases I need to point out. The first is the constant initialization. And we have a global variable whose initializer is some constant expression. So for example, a constant expression is something that can be done at compile time in a constructor function. When we have that, the global is completely initialized during static initialization, and there is no dynamic initialization for that global. So for example, in this snippet, we have a favorite number that is initialized to 11. This initialization takes place during the static initialization phase. We have the other one, the answer, that calls some constructor function. This initialization also takes place during the static phase. So after the static phase is done, those two variables are completely initialized. And it is important to point out that this is a guarantee. This is not an optimization. Whenever we have a global whose initializer is a constant expression, that global will be initialized completely during the static initialization phase and basically at compile time. The second special case is a function local static. Function local static have the same static initialization phase. So they're set to zero or to the final value if they have a constant initializer, but dynamic initialization is deferred until control flow first reaches the definition. So on this snippet, we have a compute function that defines two static variables. Input has a constant initializer, so it will be initialized at compile time, but result has a dynamic initializer because it accesses some other global, which means it will only be initialized the first time control flow reaches the definition, which happens at the bottom at the compute false call. In particular, we never call compute with a false argument, result will never be initialized. With that in mind, we can create our first initialization timeline. So when we start our program, we first perform constant initialization and zero initialization. Then we perform dynamic initialization. Then we start executing main. And during the execution of main, we perform dynamic initialization of function local static variables as needed. And because of this ordering, it is impossible to read uninitialized global memory. So in this snippet, global reads the value of other. This will either be zero, because the read is only performed after static initialization, at which point everything is zero, or it will read the final value if it happens to be dynamically initialized. Okay. Are there any questions about the basic rules so far?
So no questions so far.
Okay. Then we get to what makes C++ great. We get to various edge cases. The first edge cases are inline variables. When we have a header file, we can define a global using the inline keyword. Much like an inline function, that global will have multiple definitions, but the linker will throw them all out except for one. So that allows us to define a global directly in the header. We do that here, and then we also define another global that reads that value. Is this read going to be okay? Is the dynamic initialization of global going to happen before the read? What about the other two variables? We have two different translation units. They both include the header and they both read global. Are those reads going to be okay? Well, intuitively, you want at least H to work all the time because H is practically defined in the same translation unit, so it should be initialized after. And for A.cpp and B.cpp, well, technically, they're both defined in that translation unit. So within one translation unit, they're initialized from top to bottom. But this means that it would have that the inline would be initialized twice, once in each translation unit. So this can't work. The translation units would have to coordinate which one is going should initialize it and which one doesn't, which doesn't really work with the C++ compilation model of compiling every translation unit in parallel. So the standard basically says that inline variables are initialized as if they were defined in one arbitrary translation. This makes the read of a global by H okay, because whatever translation units the inline variables end up being initialized in, H will be after global, so initialized after global. But neither the reads in A and B.cpp is going to work, guaranteed, because it might not be the translation unit where they're initialized. Then we've got templated variables. A templated variable happens when we have a global variable that is either directly a variable template or a static member of a class template. Now, those are special because they do not actually exist until we instantiate the template. This means if you never instantiate the template, no dynamic initialization takes place. And only the dynamic initialization for particular types takes place. This means that the dynamic initialization sort of depends on the instantiation point of the template. So whatever translation units end up instantiating the template first, this is the one that's going to initialize them. So the standard basically makes no guarantees about any order. It says that templated variables are initialized before main at some point, but we don't have any ordering relationship. We cannot reliably access other globals from the initializer of a templated variable because they might not be initialized. As an optimization, the compiler is also allowed to perform dynamic initialization at compile time. So this is the same snippet as before. Now only f is no longer context bound. But the call could still be executed at compile time. So the compiler can choose to optimize it and perform dynamic initialization at compile time. But unlike the case it was before, this is now only an optimization. The compiler is no longer required. When f was marked context bound, the compiler is required to perform static initialization and completely omit dynamic initialization. Here it is only an optimization. The compiler is also allowed to do the opposite. Delay dynamic initialization after main has started executing. So in this snippet, we have a global variable that wants to remember the time our application has started. But the compiler is allowed to defer initialization until the first read, basically. So our startup time is set to the time whenever we first read it, which is not really ideal. In particular, if we never read a global variable, it might not be initialized at all. This is what basically makes dynamically loaded libraries work. Because they're loaded at runtimes at some point during main, only then can their variables be dynamically initialized. So they have to be deferred. Those were a lot of rules, but the important takeaway is that the dynamic initialization order of globals defined in different translation units is not specified. This lack of order in the dynamic initialization is called the static initialization order fiasco. The static and static initialization refers to static storage duration, not the dynamic initialization, which isn't ordered. Naming is hard. And with that, we can understand what went wrong in our original problem. We have a logger that is defined in logger.cpp, and we have an application that is defined in main on cpp. Those are different translation units, so the compiler can initialize one before the other, however it wants. And it seems like Clang chose to initialize their translation units in the order they were passed in the compiler. So when we pass logger.cpp first, it will be initialized first and everything works. But if we pass main.cpp first, the application object runs is initialized first, which accesses an incorrect peak logger. And the problem can be a bit more subtle than that. Let's suppose we use cout directly. Cout is a global variable, so is this going to be okay? What about using puts? Now, puts doesn't use a global variable directly, but internally, the standard out probably has some buffer or something or some other internal machinery that has to be initialized. So is this going to work? What about allocating memory? The heap has lots of control structures. Are those going to work? So the general guideline is this. Unless otherwise allowed by its documentation, you should never access global state in the construct of another global. Okay, Klaus, you just let me know when there are questions. I think it's easier that way.
All right, perfect. Just go on. Okay. Thank you.
Okay, so we need to, when we want to allow it, which we want in our logger, it should be able to log messages at any point. We need to somehow ensure it is going to be initialized. So let's take a look for the rest of the talk at techniques that allow us to do exactly that. The first technique is to leverage constant initialization. The rule was that globals initialized by some constant expression are completely initialized during static initialization. And because by definition, a constant expression cannot access a global that is dynamically initialized, this is completely fine. This completely avoids the static initialization problem because we don't access global state. This means that whenever possible, you should make a global variable constexpr. That way, the compiler checks that the initializer is a constant expression, and it has to perform the initialization at compile time because it can be used at compile time. So we will never access incomplete global state by using constexpr. If we try to do that, we get a compiler. The compiler gives an error message. Of course, there's a big downside to that. The global variable is always immutable, and fully only a complete compile time constant. This is not always what we want. But we still can write a mutable global variable, but just need to use a constant initializer. That way, it is also going to be initialized at compile time, but it is not immutable. And there are some surprising cases of constant initialization. For example, std mutex has a constexpr default constructor. This means that when you have a global std mutex, it will be initialized at compile time, which means that whenever you have a global mutex, you can just freely lock it at any point. It has always been initialized. And this doesn't really seem obvious because mutex seems like this runtime only thing that it has probably has a non-trivial destructor as well. So how, but it still has a constexpr default constructor, which allows constant initialization, which avoids the problem. But this isn't really obvious and it gets worse. It isn't enough that the constructor or the initializer is a constexpr function. So for example, in this example, we have a function that is marked as constexpr, but when useDefault is false, it will call stdGetCHAR, which isn't constexpr yet. So the answer calls compute true, which is a compile time expression. So this will be used initialized using constant initialization. But the response calls compute false, which uses getcher, which isn't a compile time thing, so it will use dynamic initialization. It isn't enough that the function you call is marked as const expert. The branch you take in that function has to be completely const expert as well. So it would be nice if there was some way to mark a global variable as, hey, compiler, please ensure that it uses constant initialization. This prevents accidental error and also makes it really obvious just from looking at the declaration that the variable is safe to use at any point. And luckily, C++20 adds exactly such a feature. The constinit keyword. Constinit is the const expert without the const. It means that the global variable is initialized using constant initialization, else you get an error, but the variable is not const and can be freely changed at runtime. So we can use our constinit std mutex. This is always, if it compiles, it is always okay. We can use constinit the answer. It is okay. But if you try to use constinit the response that uses getcher, this is an error because it does not use constant initialization. So whenever you define a global, you should mark it as constinit. That way the compiler checks initialization problems. If the call compiles, fine, you can just leave the constinit and the global is safe. Otherwise, you have to use some other alternative. And it is again important to point out that constinit does not actually change the initialization time. But if you mark it as constinit and it compiles, it will be initialized at compile time. If you then remove the constinit, it is still going to be initialized at compile time. Constinit merely requires that it is initialized at compile time. This makes it really easy to start using constinit today. Just write a macro that expands to nothing if constinit isn't available. Once you upgrade to C++20, you will automatically have a check for the initialization of all your globals. And this is the first thing I will add to my Atom library. It has the Atom constinit macro you can start using today if you want constant initialization. The existence of constant initialization also has consequences for your type design. You should try to add a const expression constructor to every type you write. That way, it is possible to add a global variable that is completely initialized at compile time. So you don't run into the dynamic initialization or static initialization all of your state. So for example, the default constructor of containers doesn't really allocate memory and probably just sets some pointers to null, so it could be const expert. That way you can safely create a global container that is initialized at compile time. Or resource handles like files and sockets, it probably have an empty state, which can be defined in a const expert default constructor. So do that, and you can have more and more const init. However, we can't really apply the const init solution to our logger, because the default constructor of a logger opens a file, which isn't a compile time operation. So instead, we need to change our logger a bit. Instead of opening the file, we only open it on demand. So we put the ostimer object in an std optional, which has a const expert default constructor. So this is nice. Then we can, our default constructor is const expert, and we can const init our logger. And we just need to change the definition of our log function to check whether we have a file, and if not, we open it. Okay, you let me know if there are questions, right?
So one question is, why is it called const init if it hasn't anything to do with const? Do you know why the committee chose this name?
Yeah, well, it's const init because you have constant initialization, right?
All right.
That's const and init, constant initialization.
All right.
Okay. Now, one downside with using const init with our logger is that we now do a form of lazy initialization. And the way we do this here is not that safe. It doesn't matter with our logger because it wasn't that safe to begin with. But if you want that safety, it's really difficult to perform lazy initialization by hand. So do not use const init if you then need to do lazy initialization. There's a much better solution for that. So let's take a look. The second way is lazy initialization. It is impossible to access an uninitialized global if we perform the initialization of the global on first use. And we can leverage function local static. They are initialized when control flow first reaches the definition. And C++11 also guarantees that it is that safe. So this is nice. So before we just define our global, and then we run into access problems potentially. but for function local statics. We define our global as a function local static inside some function, and then we call the function. And this access is now always safe, because if the global hasn't been initialized, it will simply by accessing. However, I've never really liked that solution, because now to access a global variable, we have to call a function, which I guess makes sort of sense, because we are doing non-trivial work on access, but I never really liked it. So once I tried to do this, I edit a global reference that points to the global object. And then we can access it through the reference without the annoying extra parentheses. But this is problematic, because even though the global object G is always initialized on demand, the reference might not be. So when we follow our earlier guideline and add const init, this fails to compile because the global reference isn't initialized at compile time. So this means it is initialized at some point during dynamic initialization, which means it isn't always safe to access. It might not be initialized, and so point to nothing, basically. And so we've got a null reference that we access. So you should never cache a reference or even a copy of a function local static in a global variable. This completely defeats the entire point of lazy initialization, and you have the same problems as before. And again, if you conservatively try to mark everything with const init, the compiler will help and point to errors. So let's go a different approach to eliminate the syntactic overhead. My idea was to create some sort of smart pointer that performs initialization on demand. Called it lazy init. We have our get function that defines a function local static, and then we return that. And we also give it pointer to metrics. The default constructor of our lazy init is const expert, which means that the smart pointer itself can be initialized at compile time. So it is always initialized. And when we dereference it, it will initialize the underlying object on demand. It's important to point out that a function local static of a class is the same for every object of the class. So we need to go ahead and add this additional tag type. This is just there to allow us to have two lazy init ints. In order to have two lazy init ints, each object must have a different type. So we just define dummy type and pass it as first template parameter with each declaration. That way we get a new type, and so a new fresh function local static. And this is also something I did to my Atom library. So with Atom, we can write const init Atom lazy init, we give it some tag unique for each definition, and create our global. Then we can access it, and if it hasn't been initialized, it will be initialized anyway. Apply to a logger, it looks like this. We can keep the class definition the same. We just change the type of the global variable to be a const init, atom lazy init, with some tag, and then just add the const init to the definition as well. And now all we need to do is change the access to use pointer semantics instead of dot. And then we have a logger that is lazily initialized, so we can safely use it in the constructor of application. And if main is initialized first, the application object will lazily initialize the logger. However, one downside with lazy initialization is that the first call might be expensive. So when the first time we call logger is in some hot loop, this might open a file, which might slow things down. But this is by the very nature of lazy initialization. Just watch out for that. Any questions about this solution?
So not yet.
Okay.
Right. Yeah.
Then I'll just go on, because we're not quite done with that solution yet. This seemed to work, so we extend our application class and add a destructor. This destructor wants to log application shutdown. But is this okay? We know that if logger hasn't been initialized, it will be initialized. But what if the logger object has already been destroyed? It has a destructor. At that point, that is called. So we need to take a look at the rules for global variable destruction. What does the standard say about when destructors of global variables are called? The standard says that global variables are destroyed in reverse dynamic initialization order. This is the same for every other variable. Everything is destroyed in reverse order. However, there's one caveat, which is when we have a global that has a constant initializer. If you have a global that has a constant initializer, it has now dynamic initialization. But the destruction order it still happens in the reverse order of the position where the dynamic initializer would have taken place. Let's take a look at an example. We have three globals, A, B, and C. A is regular one, B is const init, and C is a function of its type. So we know that based on the rules, we will first initialize B because it is const init. Then we perform dynamic initialization of A, start executing the main function, which will then perform dynamic initialization of C. Destruction is now going in reverse dynamic initialization order. So we first destroy C, because C was created last, so we destroy it first. Then we destroy B. If B had a dynamic initializer, it would be dynamically initialized after A. So we destroy it before A. Finally, we destroy A, because this is the object that whose dynamic initializer runs first. And while these rules seem a bit weird, it is what you intuitively expect. B is defined after A, so B could safely access A, which means that we need to delay the destruction of A until B has been destroyed. If B was destroyed last, it might be its destructor might access an A object that has already been destroyed. With that, we can complete our initialization timeline to get the entire program time. So we perform the initialization, start executing main, initialize the function local static variables as needed. Then we destroy the function local static variables that were initialized in reverse order. This happens strictly before our lab. And then we destroy the other globals in reverse order. Now, the standard guarantees reverse order from initialization order, but it doesn't initialize the initialization order in the first place. This means that the destruction order of globals in different translation units isn't specified either. Let's call this the static destruction order fiasco. Nobody seems to talk about that, but it has the same problems as static initialization order. In particular, unless otherwise allowed by its documentation, you should do not access global state in the destructor of another global. And it is important to point out this even applies to const init globals. Our const init mutex presumably has some non-trivial destructor. So while it is safe to use it in the constructor, it isn't safe to be used in the destructor because it might be destroyed. So you need to watch out for that. So this code, where we have a logger that we log in the application, we can basically guarantee that this is not going to work. Because logger, the first time it was used, was in the constructor of application, which means the logger object was created after application. This means it is destroyed before application. So by the time the destructor runs, the function local static has long been gone and we crash or something like that. This means that you should not use a function local static variable if there's a chance it might be used after. And you can even go more conservative and say, do not use function local statics. While the initialization order is completely fine, they have unnecessary early destruction, which isn't always desirable. So you have to really watch out for that. This means that this lazy init implementation is broken. How do we fix it? We need to ensure that our global object isn't destroyed until after the last use. The easiest way to do that is to never destroy it at all. That makes it impossible to leak memory. That makes it impossible to access it in a destroyed state. So let's create some storage where we can put a T. And on access, we check that storage is initialized. If so, we initialize it. And then we can just refer to that T. And we never, ever destroy the T once we've initialized it. This solves a problem, but now the initialization isn't thread safe. And it is a lot of work to write an efficient and thread safe lazy initialization. So instead, I've decided to implement it using a trick. We know that a function local static is only initialized once, and this is done in a thread safe way. So we simply leverage that. In our get function, we define a function local static whose initializing expression initializes the storage for us. The first time we call get, the compiler will initialize the function local static. And by doing so, it will call storage.initialize, and then we have an object. And on subsequent calls, the function local static is already initialized. So it doesn't do anything, and we can directly return the object. One consequence of that is that when we have, for example, a const init, lazy init of a string, the string is never destroyed. So this is potentially a memory leak. Well, Clang says no, the leak sanitizer of clay. And it sort of makes sense. We've never lost the memory. We always have a pointer to it. We just never deleted it. And why would we delete it? Once our program exits, which would happen immediately after the deallocation, the operating system is going to reclaim all that memory anyway. So this isn't really a memory leak. The same is true for our logger. We have a const emit fstream object that is opened at some point, but never closed. Is this a file leak? Well, no, because the operating system is going to go ahead and close the file once we are shut down anyway. Now, if the destructor of a global does actual important work, like save the application state, then sure, this is a problem because its destructor will never be executed. But then you have to ask yourself, why did I put that important work in the destructor of a global whose destruction order isn't really specified, so it might fire in unexpected places? It is much better to do this important work before you enter main when you have full control. So that is lazy initialization. We can still leverage function local statics, but we can never destroy them. Just to be conservative and to always allow access.
All right. So by now we have a couple of questions, if this is okay for you. So all right.
Sure.
The first question is is lazy initialization the same as dynamic initialization?
So dynamic initialization is a language term. It is something the language does, and our lazy init class doesn't do dynamic initialization according to the language term because it's initialized completely during static initialization. Then when we do the access, we have some sort of dynamic initialization, but it is not implemented by the compiler, so it doesn't have the language term of dynamic initialization. In a way, we are still having dynamic initialization, we're just doing it ourselves at a very controlled point.
All right. Then second question, how is this managed with the singleton pattern?
I'll get to singleton briefly at the end of the talk. So let's discuss again.
Let's just defer that. Yeah. And there is a comment also. I just read it. It's a little more lengthy. Mm-hmm. If lazy initialization of the logger hurts, then I would expect main to initialize the logger first by calling logger.get.
This adds yes.
of main to this global, but for logger, this seems reasonable.
Yes, so the full Atom lazy init class actually has an explicit initialize method. So you can explicitly initialize the lazy init by calling that at some control point first time in main. So you can avoid that problem that way.
All right. And there's another question. What is the recommended strategy for avoiding duplicate type tags? So like this struct global tag that we see.
My idea was you just take the name of the global variable and then just declare a struct that has that name and tag. This is because the name is unique, the name of the tag is also unique. And Atom has a debug mode that will check that you don't have the same object. Basically, it will remember that this pointer in the function local static of the object that it calls initialize. And if it is already initialized with a different this pointer, this means you have duplicate tags. So it will issue an error there at runtime. I can't do that statically check that. But there's a debug mode that catches it.
All right. That sounds reasonable. Thank you. That's all.
Okay. So let's take a look at the coolest solution, basically, for avoiding the whole problem. And those are nifty counters. When we discussed the language rules, I asked whether it is okay to use cout in the constructor of a global. And the answer is yes, this is okay. The standard says so in a footnote, which isn't normative text, but it is a consequence of other normative text. So the standard guarantees that this is okay. It says that constructors and destructors for objective static storage duration, so what we've been talking about, can access cout. But how is the standard library able to make that guarantee? Is it just because the standard library is magic, or is there some technique we can employ as well? And the answer is yes, we can also guarantee that for our globals. We do that by leveraging the only order guarantee that we have, that within one translation unit, variables are initialized from top to bottom. We know two things. First, you must include a header that declares the global before using it. And we know that everything defined in that header is initialized before your global. So as the simplest solution, we can simply make our global static. That way, it is defined in each translation unit that includes the header. And unlike inline, there it still follows the same ordering guarantees. So it is defined at the point basically where the header is pasted in. And so it will be initialized before every access, because we must include the header in order to access it. Of course, the downside is this creates multiple globals. So even though both A and B.cpp will access an initialized global object, it will not be the same initialized global object. They will have different copies. But we can do the same trick we did with lazy initialization. We keep our global as defined some other translation unit, and we add a static dummy object that ensures our global is initialized as a side effect of its initialization. We know that the compiler will initialize it before everything else in that translation unit, so it is always safe. Let's add a smart pointer for that, nifty. We again have some storage, but we don't need a tag for this one because we don't have any function open static. Then we add an explicit initialize method that initializes the storage if it has been initialized. So we can use it like so. This is again something I've written in the Atom library. We have an Atom nifty init, which itself is constant initialized, so that's fine. Then we define our static initializer that calls global.initialize. Then we can access our global again with the usual smart pointer semantic. So let's walk through what happens here. If the compiler chooses to initialize everything in a.cpp before b.cpp, we will go from top to bottom and first initialize the initializer object of a.cpp. This has the side effect of initializing the global. So when we then initialize a, the global has already been initialized and everything is fine. Then the compiler will go ahead and initialize the initializer object in b.cpp. This has no effect because we've already initialized the global. And then it will initialize b, which will access a global that is already initialized. So this works. And if the compiler chooses to initialize b.cpp before a.cpp, well, the same thing happens, just now the initializer of b.cpp gets to run and initialize the global. And even if the compiler chooses to interleave dynamic initialization order, there is no way A will be initialized before global, because the initializers have to be initialized first and they will initialize global. And by looking at that, we can also destroy the global. We don't have to leak it. We know precisely the point at which it should be destroyed. It should be destroyed in the destructor of the initializer that initially initialized it. So the first initializer object whose constructor gets run is also the one whose destructor is run last. So at this point in the destructor, we can safely destroy the global because there can be no other object that still has access to the global. They've all been destroyed before. So we add a counter, and this is where the name nifty counter comes from. We add a counter to our nifty init and an initialize function that counts up. Only if the counter was zero, that means on the first call, we call storage initialize. And in the destroy function, we just count down, and when the count reaches zero again, this means we are the last one to call destroy, then we destroy the object. Then instead of having a simply dummy int, we make it a class. The class stores a reference to the nifty init and calls initialize in the constructor and destroy in the destructor. However, this has the overhead of adding like one global reference in each translation unit. This isn't really necessary because since always, we can pass references as non-type template parameters of globals, of object the static storage duration, because their address is practically known at compile time. So we can make it part of the type. Instead of having the reference as a member, we add it as a template parameter. So we create distinct types for each global object the nifty counter initializes. And that way, we don't need to store it dynamically in global memory. This is the same thing. And since C++ 17, we can use auto as a non-type template parameter, so we can reduce the parameters to just one. We can write our nifty counter for that takes an auto reference, which will be the reference to the global object that it has initialized, and it call it and destroy it. So now the code looks like this. We have a constant auto nifty init and use a nifty counter for that global. We can simply pass the global in the angle bracket and basically pass it by reference. And the initializer will statically call the appropriate initializer. So this works. Now I have a global that is initialized before first used, and destroyed after last use. But it's still obvious that we are doing a bit of magic there. We still have to use pointer semantics. And we can even go ahead and get rid of those. We know at compile time the address where the object is going to end up. So we can add a constexpr function that returns a reference to the storage that will later contain the object. This is fine. We can form a reference to storage that doesn't yet contain an object. What we can't do is actually dereference, so to speak, the reference. So every access is undefined behavior. And we know that this works because this is constexpr. And in constexpr code, the compiler has to check for UB. So because it compiles, we know that it is completely fine to get this reference. And then we can add a third global, a constant global reference that will be constant initialized to the location that will later construct the global. Then we can just access the global via that const init reference. Because at the point where we actually access it, which has to be a dynamic initializer, this initializer object was already constructed, which means the global is already initialized, which means the reference points to a valid object. If we try to be sneaky and go ahead and, let's say, access the global as a const init, this is actually a compile error, even without the const init. There are very specific rules. Let me rephrase that. This is a compile error if we use const init, because it doesn't do constant initialization. The compiler knows that we cannot access the global in a constant expression because it doesn't point to an object yet. It has to do that dynamically, and when it does that dynamically, the global has been initialized. So this works. We can now easily transfer that to our logger. We just add the nifty init object, the static counter, and the const init reference. Define that in the CPP file, and are done. We now have basically the exact same code in the application code as the one in the problem. We just no longer have the problem of initialization. Okay, are there any questions about the technique?
So it doesn't seem so.
Okay.
Yep, thank you.
And if you take a look at the standard again, this is precisely what the standard does for cout. There is this IO space init class. If you take a look at the synopsis, this is a nifty counter. It's also the only thing in the standard library whose name starts with an uppercase letter. I don't know why. The standard further says that if you include IOStream, we get an IOSpace init object with static storage duration. So we get a nifty counter object that will initialize cout. However, while nifty counters are really cool, if you try hard enough, we can break them. For example, we have a global, a class, whose default constructor prints to cout. And because we're doing nice source hygiene, we are only including IOStream in the source.cpp. Because we don't actually need it in the header, we don't access cout there, only in the source file. But if we then create a global in a different translation unit, that translation unit only include header.hpp. We don't include IOStream, which means we won't get the IOSpace init object that will actually initialize cout. So if main.cpp is initialized first, the default constructor of global will run first, which will access a cout object that hasn't been initialized yet, because cout is only initialized in the other translation unit, and we don't have any ordering guarantees there. The fix is to include IOStream in main.cpp. Even though we don't access cout, we need IOStream to get the IOSpace init object. We could also declare one ourselves, but including IOStream is easier. So this is something you have to watch out for. When you have a global that uses another global which uses a nifty counter, we need to ensure that the nifty counter object is included in the translation unit that defines the global. Usually you won't run into such a situation, I assume, because the global header will declare the global, and then the source file will define it, so we don't run into that problem. It also doesn't work with templates. If you recall the rules that when you have a template with a static data member, it does not follow the regular ordering rules, so the nifty counter object, even though we actually have one in this translation unit this time, isn't initialized in any ordered way with respect to the global. So nifty counters simply don't work for templated objects. Okay, are there anything about that now?
Okay, so there was the question, why not include IO stream in the header? But I think this has been clarified.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, we can also fix that problem, which is actually a better idea to include IO stream in the header. So when you have a class that accesses some other global in some constructor, it is a good idea to include the appropriate header to get the nifty counter object. This also prevents the problem, because now by getting access to the class, you also get the nifty counter object in your translation. Yes.
All right. And there's another question. Yeah. Again, I just read it. Doesn't this seem like a hack rather than a proper solution?
Yes. Yes. Absolutely.
Okay.
So I have a slide for that. We've taken a look at three solutions so far. Const init, which is not always applicable because it has constant initialization. Lazy initialization, which has to leak. NFT counters, which are dark black magic that are like really cool, but also not really. So there's a simple solution. And the simple solution is to don't do anything before or after main. If you don't have any dynamic initialization, you don't run into the static initialization order fiasco. Of course, this means that we have to initialize our globals manually. So finally, let's take a look at manual initialization. And I've written the appropriate smart pointer class for that, manual init. Manual init, again, uses OS storage and has explicit initialize and destroy functions that initialize and destroy it. And before we can access it, we need to call initialize or destroy. So to do that, I've added a scoped guard, a scoped initializer, constructor calls init, destructor calls destroy, similar to our nifty counter object. Basically, it's the same thing. In the library, there are aliases. So with that, we can create our manual init global, which itself is constant initialized because it doesn't have dynamic initialization. And then first thing in main, we create the scoped initializer, pass it our global, it will initialize it, and then we can access it. That way, we have full control over the order of initialization. When we have multiple globals, we can easily extend our scoped initializer to get pass it a variadic list of references, initialize them all in the constructor, and destroy them all in reverse order in the destructor. So translated to our logger, we don't need to change the class again. We create our const init logger that is uses manual init. We also need to change the application, because we need to do the application last, which means we need to create our scoped initializer that first initializes the logger, and then we pass it app. It is important that if you use this technique, you either need to use it for all your globals in your project or none of them. If you use it only for some of them will have dynamic initializer and will run before main, which makes it really a headache. You also need to be really careful about the order of initialization to account for any dependencies, which is error prone, but at least you have full control over it. And you can see the order just by looking at the source code. Isn't this implicit thing that sometimes works and sometimes doesn't, depending on what the compiler thinks at the moment. So this is definitely the solution with the most control over everything. So the Atum library. By the way, Atum is the fellow on the left, which is the Egyptian god for pre-existence and post-existence, which was just such a fitting name for a library that takes care of global variable initialization and deinitialization that happens before and after main. Also really like the archaic connotation of like globals and Egyptian gods. So it worked out nicely. Thanks to, I forgot your name. Someone suggested the name on Twitter. Thanks to you. It's a really great name. It's a C++ 17 library, single header, has minimal standard library dependencies and has a debug mode. So you can enable the debug mode and then it will check that your global has been initialized by firing an assertion. You can find it at that URL. Currently it is experimental, but I just need to add tests. I haven't found the time yet. Once they are tests, they are stable. I don't have any features for a plan, so you can just go ahead, copy that header and use it in your project. There's one feature, I haven't talked about it. All the globals currently use just called the default constructor. You can customize that by specifying an additional argument to the init classes, which controls how it's initialized. So you can choose between like init braced here will pass an initializer list to the object, or you can also just pass it a function and it will then call the function to get the object. So you can control it. You can also easily write your own init class. Just write a class, give it a static method that calls placement new to construct the objects however you want. Then someone asked about singleton. Well, a singleton is just a global where you only have one. So the same thing applies here. It's just the only difference is that you restrict your class to only allow one instance, but you still need to watch out about the lifetime and about the storage and whatnot. And in particular, the classic Mayer singleton with a function local object, this has to be a static method, of course, but never mind, doesn't really work because you get into the destruction order issues. So you need to watch out for that if you have that in your code base, that it isn't accessed in a destructor. Instead, you can use the singleton and just use atom lazy init. Same thing, semantics, and you even get nice pointer syntax instead of going through a singleton instance. Walter didn't call about thread local, but basically the same rules applied. They're globals, but instead of being initialized before main ones, they're being initialized before the thread function runs, and you have once per thread. They're also initialized in two phases, a static initialization phase that happens when the thread allocates memory, and a dynamic initialization phase before the thread starts executing. But the standard doesn't seem to make any ordering guarantees for dynamic initialization. So with thread local globals, you have to be especially careful. But at least you can safely access non-thread local globals, because by the time your thread is starting, or the main thread or whatever, they are guaranteed to all be initialized. So you can safely access regular globals in your thread local globals initializer. You just have to be really careful about accessing other thread local globals. But the destruction, same deal. They're destroyed in reverse initialization order on thread exit, but before any non-thread local globals are destroyed. So this entire talk basically started as a tweet. In September, I tweeted that every global variable should be non-existent, or const expire, which means it's immutable and initialized at compile time, or const init, which means it's mutable and initialized at compile time. That way, there is no static initialization order fiasco. If you need to do any dynamic initialization, do it after main. So that basically what I tweeted, and then I proposed a lightning talk to my local user group just about const init, because it's a nice, simple C++20 feature that people should know about. Then I submitted it as a conference talk, the conference got canceled, and now I'm here. So since September, I did some research, and there is one other C++20 feature that is related to global variable initialization. C++20 adds modules. What about modules? Because I said it is really difficult for translation units to coordinate in a dynamic initialization order in the classical C++ model, because you have a compiler, it compiles every translation unit in parallel, basically, with no communication. But with modules, you have this import dependency chain that the compiler has to work through. So you have to compile certain modules before other, which means that there is one more exception in C++20. When you have a global variable that is defined in a module that you import, that global variable is guaranteed to be initialized before your module. This means that when you have a library module that has two globals, A and B, and then import it into other translation units, you're guaranteed that A will be initialized before B. This is the same deal defined in the same translation unit, but also that both A and B will be initialized before C and D, because they are defined in a module that you import. You still won't get any order guarantee between C and D, because they are two different unrelated translation units, but every global in a library module is imported before use. So with modules, you simply go ahead, put the logger in the module, export a global object. And in our application, we just import it and use it. This is completely fine because everything in the imported module will be initialized before the application module. So the real conclusion to this talk is to go ahead and just use modules. They solve the problem. You can find the Atom library on GitHub. If you want to see the tweet that spawns my next talk, follow me on Twitter. And if you really like what I'm doing, consider supporting me. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jonathan. So we have a couple of final questions. Mm-hmm. So one question is still about the third solution that you presented.
Libdinet, yes.
Yeah. So the question is just curious how the third solution will work with relocations/pick, so the compilation flag.
You mean because we have this global reference, right? I haven't tested it, but I assume that the compiler will figure something out because it accepts this code and it accepts that it initializes it at compile time, so it will figure something out. It will presumably, like when it's loaded, like I don't know anything about dynamic relocations, but I'm presumably there's some fixer process, and this fixer process will also probably fix the global reference. So it should probably work out. What I'm not quite sure about with Nifty init is when you have dynamically loaded libraries. I'm not sure how that's going to work. So this is something you might watch out for, but for like position independent code and stuff like that, I think it should just work out fine. I hope.
All right, and then Voter had just a comment. So again, I just read it. My personal solution is a bit radical. No runtime initialized globals at all, and forced by modifying the linker script to debarf when global initialization code is present. Not user-friendly, probably problematic with third-party libraries, but it serves me well.
Yeah, well, so you're basically doing like the manual initialization, but you're just doing a linker check. Because how dynamic initialization is implemented, there's like basically this array of function pointers or something like that, that the compiler will push stuff to it, and you can just check in your linker what's in there. So yeah, that's just the final manual initialization, you just check for it. Yeah.
And there's a lot of people that love the conclusion.
Okay, good.
Okay. So thank you very much again.
You're welcome.
For everybody who is still watching, do not forget that we have an after talk chat. So we just posted a link again. So if you still have some time, if you want to ask Jonathan direct questions, or if you just want to chat with us, other fellow C++ developers, just go there. See you in a couple of minutes. All right. Thanks again, Jonathan.
You're welcome.